The following program is video supplemental instruction. VSI is brought to you by the Teaching Center, UF's Learning Support Center, www.teachingcenter.ufl.edu.
Hi there, everyone. My name is Stephanie Morton, and I am here today to talk to you guys about the pyruvate dehydrogenase complex. This is a very important mechanism. What it does, as I'm sure you guys all know, is it takes pyruvate and it's going to make acetyl-CoA and NADH and eliminate some CO2. Of course, acetyl-CoA is what goes into the TCA cycle and allows for the full breakdown of all the and utilization of all the energy from glucose. Okay, so to get started, let me just orient you guys here to our drawing. This right here is the pyruvate dehydrogenase complex. Pyruvate, CoA, and NAD+ are all kind of floating around readily available for us. And okay, so let's talk about the enzymes themselves. So the first one, called E1, is known as pyruvate dehydrogenase. And the second one, E2, is dihydrolipoyl transacetylase, and we'll talk about kind of why these are named the way they are. And the third one, E3, is dihydrolipoyl dehydrogenase. Okay, so let's get started, right? So the first thing that we're going to be working with is E1, right? Because we're moving from left to right here in the breakdown of pyruvate to make CoA. Well, acetyl-CoA, excuse me. All right, so the first thing this pyruvate's going to do is it's going to interact with TPP. TPP is thiamine pyrophosphate, okay? Thiamine pyrophosphate, all right? It is bound to E1, your pyruvate dehydrogenase, and its role is to interact directly with pyruvate and kick off a CO2 to form hydroxyethyl TPP. Now, how it does that, it has a 5-membered ring that you don't have to really know the exact structure of, but it does have a 5-membered ring that interacts with pyruvate, binds pyruvate, and kicks off the CO2. So what we're gonna see formed here as we move through, of course, we have that CO2 leaving, and that's this CO2 right here. And we're also going to see formation of, like I said, your hydroxyethyl TPP, okay? And that looks like this, okay, just like that. And of course, this is just a methyl group over here. So hydroxyethyl TPP, right? So now you have at least part of the pyruvate bound here to your TPP and overall to your pyruvate dehydrogenase complex. And we've already eliminated the CO2 that we needed to eliminate. Okay, so now we have this TPP, this hydroxyethyl TPP. And remember, it's the 5-membered ring in the thiamine pyrophosphate that's interacting with the hydroxyethyl group. So now we're gonna swing on over to E2 over here, your dihydrolipoyl transacetylase. And this dihydrolipoyl transacetylase, what it has in it is this cofactor called lipoic acid, and that's right here, and there's also sort of a carbonyl group coming up here. But the important structure of this lipoic acid is really right here in this disulfide bond in the ring structure, right? You see here, this allows for really easy reduction of each of these sulfurs, and also you can transfer acetyl groups, right? Remember, whenever we're talking about this sulfur bonding to an acetyl group, as in acetyl-CoA, we're talking about the formation of a thioester bond, okay? Those are the very high energy bonds that you find in acetyl-CoA, and they're part of what makes molecules like acetyl-CoA so useful, okay? And we're going to be forming one of these right here with our sulfur linkage, so good. All right, so what we're going to be doing, right, is transferring this acetyl group, right? Really, it's a hydroxyethyl group here, but we're going to be transferring it to one of your sulfurs right here. And so what that's going to form is, as we just kind of move around a circle here, okay, that's going to form is, okay, you're going to have one sulfur that's reduced, right? And then you're going to have the other sulfur that has an acetyl group attached to it, okay? And that's going to look like this, right? And then we have our CH3. So as you can see, here we have our thioester bond, right? So this is our very high energy bond, right? And that is the exact same bond that's going to form in acetyl-CoA. So now we've made life really easy for ourselves. All we have to do is transfer this thioester bond over to this CoASH that's just kind of floating out there. Okay, so now what we're going to do, and this lipoamide group, remember it's called a lipoamide group because it's actually, or lipolysine is another word, because it's actually attached to a lysine residue on E2. So, and it is able to swing around just as I've drawn it here. And then it comes over to CoA, right? So CoA is going to interact with this group and form acetyl-CoA, right? So this sulfur right here is going to take this acetyl group from the sulfur on lipoic acid that's attached to your lysine on E2. Okay, so what we're going to form is our CoA, and then our sulfur, of course, and that hydrogen is going to go away. And so now we have our acetyl-CoA. Okay, so hopefully you guys can still see this. My marker is dying a little bit, but okay, so now we have our acetyl-CoA, and that can just kind of float away into solution, right? So your CoA and your acetyl-CoA are not bound to the enzyme, so you don't have to worry about regenerating those things. Another CoA can just flow in. And I'm going to start using green now that we have generated our acetyl-CoA, right? So mission accomplished, right? We've made acetyl-CoA, we've kicked off carbon dioxide. Well, we haven't made NADH yet, but we'll do that because now if you see, well, I guess you don't see, but our lipoic acid group is, if I can draw it here, our lipoic acid group is completely reduced right here, okay? So both of these sulfurs have hydrogens on them. That can't react with the hydroxyethyl TPP. We need to regenerate our disulfide. Remember this right here that was so important to us to begin with to form that thioester bond. So conveniently, and by no means a coincidence, we have an FAD here that's bound to our E3, our dihydrolipodehydrogenase. And so now what we're going to do is we're going to take these hydrogens here and we're going to transfer them on to FAD to make FADH2. Okay, which you guys should be very familiar with. Again, that FAD has that isoalloxazine ring that allows it to gather in these hydrogens, our flavonadenine dinucleotide. Okay, and now we've regenerated our disulfide. Okay, so that's great, right? Because we took these hydrogens off. So these hydrogens sort of go onto here, and now we have this new bond formed. So awesome. Okay, but now we're stuck with FADH2 at the end, right? What do we do with that? Because that's bound to this enzyme. It can't just float off and go onto the electron transport chain. We have to do something to regenerate that FAD. Luckily, we have NAD plus in solution floating quite nearby that can come over here and it can actually oxidize this FADH2 back to FAD and form NADH itself and also another H plus, of course. And that can just then float off into solution much like our acetyl-CoA did, okay? So now, if we go through this, right, we've regenerated our FAD, we've regenerated our lipoic acid with our disulfide here, we've regenerated TPP as we did in the second step, when we transferred that acetyl group. So another thing of pyruvate can now flow in here and go straight through this mechanism, just like we've outlined it, and everything will go through. So let's review very quickly. Pyruvate comes over to TPP to form hydroxyethyl TPP, eliminating a CO2. The TPP has a 5-membered ring that interacts directly with pyruvate. Then, the disulfite of the lipoic acid on E2 that's attached to a lysine residue can take the hydroxyethyl group from TPP to form an acetyl group on your lipoic acid and regenerate the TPP, of course, and then the other sulfur is reduced. And remember, we formed this thioester bond here. Now all we have to do is transfer that thioester bond over to the CoA SH to form acetyl-CoA, which can then float off into solution. But now we have a fully reduced lipoic acid, and then FAD steps in to take that reduced lipoic acid, oxidize it back to your normal lipoic acid with just this disulfite group that can then interact with future TPP, the hydroxyethyl TPP. So we formed FADH2 over here. NAD comes in and oxidizes FADH2 to form FAD and NADH, and then the NADH can just float off into solution. So I hope that was clear for you guys. That again is the pyruvate dehydrogenase complex, and we went through the mechanism in there and the sort of the structure of the cofactors involved as well. We'll go into regulation in a different video. So if you have any questions about that, remember, you can always ask your instructor, or you can ask someone else to have them help you. Maybe even a classmate can help you on this. So, and your book is also a great resource. So again, my name is Stephanie Morton, and today we reviewed the pyruvate dehydrogenase complex.
The Teaching Center, UF's Learning Support Center, www.teachingcenter.ufl.edu.